Hello viewers, welcome to Law & Plan. With us today we have Mr. Manish Dhemla, who is a partner with the leading law firm Cochran Company. So he's one of those rare lawyers who has a rich experience not only in dispute resolution but also in corporate work. So in this session we'll talk about how his experience in dispute resolution helps him in his work in corporate law, and also how the field of online dispute resolution will grow in India. And also, we'll get to know him a little better. So, first of all, hi sir, how are you?
I'm good, Amya, and thank you for the introduction. First of all, I'd like to greet the viewers. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending upon the time of the day that you'll be watching this. And thank you, Amya and Law Unplugged, for inviting me here, and then to have the persistence of continuing to pursue me and make this interview possible. Thank you.
Great, sir. Excellent. So my first question to you being that when I saw your LinkedIn profile, I was very intrigued by that the fact that you are a dispute resolution lawyer and also a corporate lawyer. So the fact that most lawyers in law firms, the work is very monotonous. So what makes you able to practice dispute resolution as well as corporate law simultaneously and seamlessly?
Thank you, Amay, for this question. And it's an interesting story. I started my career as an independent litigator, and I was practicing mainly before the district courts in Delhi and had a few matters before the Honorable Delhi High Court. After about 14 months of independent practice, I thought of joining a law firm for various reasons. And I approached Mr. Rohit Kochar, who's the managing partner of Kochar & Co. I pitched to him that I'll develop the intellectual property litigation practice of the firm. Because at that time, I gathered that Cochran & Co. did not have much IPR litigation. He was completely thrilled with the idea. He liked me as a person. So he called up the IP head in Gurgaon, Mr. Tarvinder Singh. And he said that I have recently hired two associates and I don't have the budget for another one. So they had some negotiation over the phone, and it was finally decided that my cost would be allocated 50% to the IPR team and 50% to the corporate team. Unfortunately, there was no litigation partner in the Gurgaon office at that time. So that's how I started working in Cochar & Co. for both the IPR team and the corporate team. Now, naturally, the IPR team already had too many people. They were two recent hires. So I did not have much work to do on the IPR side, but the corporate team had a lot of work. And those were some of the biggest transactions, and I was feeling very happy working on those, and I was kind of enjoying that work. And after a few months, it was decided that I'll be transferred 100% to the corporate team. And I was happy with that decision. Now, after about 2 years of doing only corporate work, I started missing litigation because that was my first love, you know, appearing before the courts, going to the courts and all those things. And an opportunity came after about 2-3 years where there was a corporate matter which went into a dispute. And I volunteered to assist with that because I was already aware of the facts. And slowly and gradually, one matter turned into two into three. And after about a year, 50% of the work that I was doing was corporate work, and 50% was litigation or arbitration. And after another 3 or 4 years, I decided now I really need to decide where I need to be. I can't just keep dabbling with both kind of work. And since litigation was my first love, I obviously leaned towards it. And I started focusing more on litigation and dispute resolution. But in fact, even today, about 30% of the work that I do is what you would categorize as corporate work. So I have worked as a corporate lawyer, as an IPR lawyer, as a dispute resolution lawyer. And I've done a lot of other work in other fields. So Cochran & Co. calls itself a full service law firm. And we have this joke going around that Manish Dhemla is a full service lawyer. So, for young lawyers, I'll advise that it's not possible for everyone to, you know, really do too many different kinds of work, but always just try out different things before deciding to finalize on a specialization. these days I've seen young lawyers directly getting into competition law, which is a very, very niche practice. So my advice would be that try out different practice areas, and maybe after 2-3 years, 4 years, 5 years, then decide to specialize, which field you want to specialize into. It'll also give you a much wider perspective when you are advising a client. So if a client comes to me for advice in a corporate matter, I know how it will play out in litigation. I know if there are any IPR issues. I know if there are any competition law issues, right? They don't have to go to 20 different lawyers for one thing. Yes, I may internally, you know, consult a competition law partner, consult our IPR partner, consult our tax partner, but I would have that sense that what could be the issues and whether I need to involve them or not. So always, just don't rush into specializing. Try out different practice areas, work in different practice areas, and then think of a specialization.
Great, sir. Great, sir. I mean, as a fact, I am also interested in competition law. So, yeah, your advice will really be very valuable. And I need to experiment on many other fields of law, and then actually, I very much can actually concur with you that, okay, you must know something of everything and everything of something. So if that makes sense.
Yes, as a lawyer, you need to, because if a client comes to you for advice and you're not able to envisage what red flags could be there. So I'm not saying that you have to be a specialist in everything, but at least if someone is coming to you, you should know that, okay, there could be a potential tax issue. You flag it for the client, tell him that, okay, I'm not a tax lawyer, but I know that there could be these tax issues here. If you want, you can take advice from some external tax consultant, or I can speak to my tax partner and get back to you on this. Right? But if you leave something unaddressed, if the client has come to you and suppose there is an issue of permanent establishment and you've not told him, tomorrow he'll feel that this lawyer could not even envisage that there could be this risk.
Yes, sir. Very, very rightly said, sir. And so, sir, moving ahead with the fact that you said that lawyer should be able to give a very comprehensive and a very wider perspective to his client when it comes to dispute resolution or any other matter for that, see, be it tax or corporate. So the question being, did your practicing in litigation help you give better advices to corporate clients because you had a fair understanding of how it will go out in the dispute resolution part?
Definitely, Rajesh. I think those 2-3 years when I practiced exclusively in the corporate law domain, it made me a better litigation lawyer. Because what happens is that, and I'll talk about both the things, how my corporate law practice helped in dispute resolution and how dispute resolution helps you in advising clients in corporate matters. When I talk about the corporate practice helping in dispute resolution, now suppose you've never drafted an agreement from scratch, you've never negotiated an agreement, right? You may not be in a situation where you can persuade a judge as to why a particular interpretation of an agreement that you're canvassing is correct. But if you've been on the other side, you know why particular clauses are drafted, what goes into negotiating them, what is the intent of the parties when a certain clause is being inserted, you'll be able to persuade a judge much better. I'm not saying that you may not be able to persuade a judge at all, but it gives you a slight edge over someone who has not worked in that field. As far as corporate lawyers are concerned, I'll give you an example. Once I came across an agreement to sell, it was drafted by a lawyer from one of the biggest law firms in India. And they were representing the buyer. And the specific relief act as it then stood, it's changed after the 2018 amendment. But as it then stood, you could not claim specific performance if damages were an adequate remedy. So he was representing the buyer. He had put a liquidated damages clause specifying that in the case of a breach, the buyer would be entitled to so-and-so liquidated damages, which is a predetermined sum and which is just and fair and all that. Now, putting that kind of a clause, he had crippled his client in the sense that now his client would not be able to specifically enforce it if the seller tomorrow refused to enter into the sale deed, right? And it happens many a times that a developer or a seller of an immovable property will take money from you in advance, and tomorrow if he's getting a much better price from someone else, he'll sell it to him, not to you, right? And he'll say, okay, I'm returning your money. No criminal case is made out. I've returned your money and I've sold it to someone else. Now, if there is such a situation where the seller is not executing the sale deed, you can go in for specific performance and compel him through the court to execute the sale deed. And before October 2018, if the court felt that damages are an adequate remedy, you can be compensated by damages. You will not be entitled to the relief of specific performance. And this lawyer, because he had done only corporate work and he saw liquidated damages clause as a standard clause, he had put in such a clause and he did not know that it will seriously prejudice his client's right to enforce the agreement. So it happens with the best law firms, with corporate lawyers in the best law firms, that sometimes they're not able to envisage how things will play out if the matter goes into a dispute.
Rightly said. I mean, it's a recipe for tragedies if you aren't having the knowledge of a lot of things. A lot of things, I mean, you should have at least a 360-degree perspective while dealing with clients.
Exactly.
Right. Over to you.
Sure. So, again, I concur with you. And the next question being that now in this COVID-19 pandemic, the world has switched to the online mode. So how do you think the field of online dispute resolution will play out in the aftermath of this COVID-19 pandemic, and how will the change be? Will it be a seamless transition, and will parties go to mediate or to arbitrate matters more than litigation?
See, online dispute resolution has existed for more than 20 years. And earlier, it was used only for disputes involving small amounts. So e-commerce disputes, suppose you bought something on eBay and you have a dispute with eBay. So I think they were the first to start online dispute resolution because the amounts involved were so less that it was not feasible for someone to go to a court or do a physical arbitration. So online dispute resolution was limited to such small matters earlier. The reason why it did not find much acceptance for high value or complex disputes until now was that despite its various benefits, we lawyers and in fact judges, arbitrators, we like to conduct hearings in flesh and blood. And most of the judges, lawyers, arbitrators, I feel they had an aversion to technology. So even today, while we are having online hearings, the courts do not want the proceedings to be recorded, right? Recently, there was a direction by Justice Suresh Kher of the Honorable Delhi High Court that we should not give the link to the hearings to anyone else apart from the lawyers because there was some nuisance created by someone in one of the hearings. Now, given that aversion to technology, in fact, I had never envisaged that I'll be appearing before courts and tribunals through video conferencing. But the COVID-19 pandemic has been a catalyst, which has really driven this change where we do not have an option but to resort to online hearings. In fact, most of the hearings which are happening these days, except in some district courts and our Delhi High Court has also started physical hearings to a limited extent, even the Supreme Court. But most of the hearings which are happening right now are online hearings. But will it be a seamless transition? I don't think that it is going to be seamless. Transition is already happening, but we have a lot of teething issues. There is still a lot of reluctance in lawyers, arbitrators, judges to conduct online hearings as far as it comes to cross-examinations or if it comes to matters which require elaborate arguments. So though urgent matters are being heard through video conferencing because we don't have a choice, I still feel that there could be a lot more acceptance and it will still take a lot of time. But as far as routine matters are concerned, where for example, in arbitration, we have these case management hearings. Like you have a preliminary hearing where you drop the arbitrators, drop the schedule of arbitration. There is a hearing for finalization of issues. So those kind of hearings would continue to happen online even after the pandemic subsides. And that's going to be a very welcome change because it used to waste a lot of time of parties to travel sometimes from different parts of the world just to attend a two-hour hearing, you know, just for framing of issues or just for drawing up the schedule for arbitration. So in that sense, there's going to be more acceptability. But I still feel that there's a long way to go when lawyers become more comfortable in addressing panel arguments in complex matters. Now, I do a lot of infrastructure-related arbitration, and we have matters where you have documents running into 50,000 pages, 70,000 pages. Now, in that kind of matters, it may be almost impossible right now, given the state of infrastructure, given the state of technology, to envisage a very efficient online hearing. But I'm sure that as we adapt better, it will become more acceptable, and we'll have regular cross-examinations, and even complicated matters, complicated arguments would be heard through video conferencing. But it's going to take time. We are going to have teething issues, and we are still getting over them. The silver lining is that we have become more open to it now. I think there was another part to your question where you had asked whether the parties will now resort to mediation mode or arbitration mode. I believe yes, because in any case, we already had a lot of backlog of cases in our courts. Now with the pandemic, the backlog is only increased. Right now, the courts are taking up only urgent matters. But once hearing of normal matters resumes, there's going to be a rush of cases. And we're already, justice is already delayed in our country. It's going to be more delayed. And I believe that more and more parties are going to prefer settling disputes through mediation or maybe adopt arbitration rather than going to the courts. In fact, there was a very important amendment in the Commercial Courts Act some time ago, which is not received that much recognition. That was about pre-institution mediation. So if you are instituting a commercial suit, as a plaintiff, you have to first mandatorily resort to a mediation unless the matter is very urgent. So that still also has its problems because if the defendant does not appear or if the defendant chooses not to participate, then it is deemed that the mediation has failed and you can go to the court. So that also needs to be fixed, but I think there could be more steps taken legislatively also to promote more of ADR and mediation. And it's going to be something which is going to be more in vogue than earlier.
Right, sir. And just to add on to that, I guess the law says that if it is a commercial matter, then the parties first go to the court. And if the judge sees that there are elements in which a settlement can be achieved, then the court can refer the matter to a mediation. So I recently wrote on this topic that, okay, if can't we make mediation mandatory, that why not go to mediation before even going to court?
Amey, you'll be happy to know that in commercial matters, there was an amendment to the Commercial Courts Act by which pre-institution mediation has been made mandatory. But people avoid that by putting in an application, for instance, under Order 39, Rules 1 and 2, for an urgent relief. In such a case, it is not mandatory. You can go to the court directly without resorting to mediation. Also, there is a provision that if the defendant does not appear in the mediation, then it is automatically deemed to have failed and there are no consequences on the defendant for not appearing. So that also encourages this thing of not having to go to mediation. So there are still a lot of loopholes despite that amendment, and parties are still trying to avoid that. But on paper, in case of commercial suits, pre-institution mediation has been made mandatory.
Right, sir. Okay. Sure. Great. It was nice to know that.
Also adding to that, now that Amay has very much established in the first in the introduction itself that he has a very penchant for competition matters. So he came up with this very ingenious idea that maybe there should be mediation should not only be restricted to competition or any other issue, say family law or any other issue of that sort, but it should also go international. And before the Singapore Convention came into force, that very recently the Singapore Convention on mediation has come into force. So me and Amay were actually contemplating on writing a paper on advocating that there should be a convention which enforces mediation or which sets up a very uniform framework for mediation across the states. But maybe it wasn't supposed to go that way, so that in between Singapore Convention came in between of our article and the idea could never fructify. So anyways.
Thank you, Rajesh, for actually bringing this up. Again, one thing which you wanted to add to that is also that, see, if it comes to maritime law, so for maritime law, we have UNCLOS, we have UNCTLOS. So, I mean, the arbitration of maritime disputes has a good established in infrastructure. So something for mediation is not yet very much built. So, I mean, that is why, you know, parties can get another reason to pursue arbitration other than mediation. So we wanted to write on that also, but again, the Singapore Convention is just deals with everything, I guess.
Right, you'll have many more topics to write about, I'm sure.
Yeah. Definitely, I mean, this interview has opened a lot of avenues for us as well. We'll search upon the pre-institutional mediation part now. And moving ahead, yes.
And I would say that no research, no study goes waste. I'm sure it'll help you later on at some or the other point of time.
Sure, sir. It will. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, we hope it does as soon as possible. And so moving on, sir, to the last question of the segment. Now we have talked about mediation, we have talked about arbitration, and the only thing left is negotiation to cover the from the field of dispute resolution, alternative dispute resolution. So now you have also been very actively posting and promoting negotiation videos on your LinkedIn profile. So why do you think that negotiation is very essential for lawyers and law students, and how would you advise budding lawyers and students to develop the skill of negotiation?
Thank you for the question, Rajesh. See, negotiation skills are important not only for lawyers but for everyone. So every day you are negotiating with people in some or the other way, whether you are buying vegetables or you might be convincing your parents to buy you a new phone or trying to get an internship with a law firm, you may be buying a new car. Even when you are planning a vacation with family, you are negotiating, right? So negotiation is an essential part of everyday life. And when it comes to the profession of law, whether you are a corporate lawyer or a dispute resolution lawyer, you need to be adept at negotiation. So as a corporate lawyer, you may negotiate various kinds of agreements or other transaction documents. As a dispute resolution lawyer, a lot of times the parties may decide to settle, and you may have to assist them with negotiations. So it is something which is extremely essential for whichever kind of professional you may be, and even more so for lawyers. And I'd been thinking for a long time that, you know, I should pass on some value to people through short videos. And I could have chosen to talk about recent law amendments, judgments, which is all typical lawyer stuff. Then I thought that, one, it's boring, and secondly, a lot of people in my LinkedIn connections are not lawyers, so it may not appeal to them. And then I zeroed in on negotiation because it was something which I had some kind of experience in, which could be made very interesting, could be explained easily, and it is something which appeals to almost everyone. So that's how I decided that, okay, let me start with making videos on negotiation. And you ask how should lawyers and law students go about learning the art of negotiation. See, there is nothing like experience, right? as a lawyer, the more negotiations you will be involved in, the more you will learn. But you can definitely read some books, watch some videos, observe people who are negotiating. If you're working with some senior, you can observe their body language, their tone, maybe try to decipher what kind of a tactic they're trying to use whenever they are saying something. And then whatever you've learned, you need to apply it practically. Now, the good part is that you get various opportunities for negotiation even in your normal life, right? So whatever you've read, the next time suppose you're going to buy something, try to apply some of these skills that you've gathered or you've assimilated, and just have that mindset, that intent of getting better at each day, because it is something which is a very important skill. Even when you are talking about your fees with clients, you're negotiating with them. Suppose you are working with a senior or a law firm, you are negotiating a compensation. So the money you make or the money you save really depends upon negotiation. Apart from, what value you may provide to your clients, what you may bring to the table as a lawyer, if you are a good negotiator. Apart from that, it's going to help you in your personal life as well a lot.
Right, sir. Right. Just to add on to that, I mean, the reason why I got the opportunity to actually connect with you was your video, which with regard to the crunches. You stated that crunch often and you go on crunching, and you start the offer which is very high, so that when you bargain, the other side also thinks that okay, we have got a reasonable offer, and you also think that okay, what I want. So
that was. I would just like to clarify here that all these techniques, they are not universal. They don't have to be applied every time. You really have to see the context, the setting. Some of these things may work wonderfully in India if you're dealing with both Indian parties. But if one of the parties, for instance, is British, and if you start with a very high offer, he or she is going to be really annoyed. And it will not have the same effect on an Indian party. Similarly, if some American has given you a very reasonable offer and you're crunching, he may not take it well. So you have to be mindful of the cultural differences. You have to be mindful of the relative bargaining power of the parties. And all this comes with experience. So though that crunching and starting very high, those kind of things may help you in certain circumstances, may not help you in certain circumstances. You develop that discretion when to use them with experience.
Right. Great. I mean, the part of the equal power to negotiate terms in the contract, yeah, was something which is really important in any contract. So if you are negotiating from a position of strength, then if you crunch, then yeah, that will actually be useful to you. But yeah, right, sir. So this brings us to the next segment, which we call the On Your Fingertips Round. It is kind of similar to a rapid fire. So my first question is, can you tell us three things which are in your bucket list?
Three things in my bucket list. Okay. One is Vipassana. So it's something where you get disconnected from the whole world for 10 days. You can't even speak, and you're served very simple food. So it really helps you get your act together, detoxifies your mind. So that's something which I want to do, but it's extremely difficult to find 10 days in a row when you can be completely off the grid. So it's something which I want to do. I'm hoping I'll get some time someday. So that's on the top of my list. Second thing is that I want to learn calligraphy. I had a very bad handwriting as a child, and one of my friends is very good at calligraphy, and I once saw him doing calligraphy, and I was so impressed. I was like, I wish I could write like this. So calligraphy is the second thing which is on my bucket list. Third thing, it would sound very funny, but I would like to have six-pack abs someday. I have come close a few times, but you know, then my persistence gave up. So that's the third thing on the bucket list.
Great, great, sir. I mean, in the starting of the interview, I said, the last thing I said was, we'll get to know Manish sir better. So I guess this has done exactly that. So again, second question being that, can you name a case which you were a part of, which has many memories, and the case which you, I guess, cherish the most?
I would say that this was a case in May 2007. And it was my first final arguments before the Honorable Delhi High Court. And I was supposed to appear before Justice Pradeep Nandraj Jog. And he is known to be a very straightforward judge. He comes prepared. And our client had lost before two forums. This was a revision petition. And I was engaged at the time of filing of rejoinder. So obviously, first time I was appearing there, and the only prior experience I had of final arguments was in moot courts. Okay. So Justice Nandraj Jog completely ripped me, tried to completely rip me apart. And he was someone who would ask a lot of questions. And obviously there were two judgments against me. So there was no way in the world he would have allowed the petition. And if we have some time, I can get into the details. Otherwise, I'll just make it really short.
Sure, sir. You would love to hear that.
So this was a revision petition arising out of an Order 9 Rule 13, which is that an ex parte decree was passed against my client. And my client filed an Order 9 Rule 13 application for setting aside the ex parte decree before the civil judge. The civil judge dismissed that application. The ground was that the limitation period for that has to be counted from the date of knowledge of the decree. And the date of knowledge was not mentioned in the application. So there was a technical lacuna there. The ADJ dismissed it on the same ground that you've not mentioned the date of knowledge in your application, and therefore the limitation, whether you're within limitation or not, cannot be ascertained. Therefore, it is dismissed as being out of limitation. Now, when we were before, when I was arguing before Justice Nandraj Jog, I started narrating the facts, and I just said three or four words, and Justice Nandraj Jog said, "Counsel, first of all, tell me, where have you mentioned the date of knowledge?" So I said, "Your Lordship, that it is not mentioned in the Order 9 Rule 13 application, but it was mentioned in the accompanying application for stay on execution of the decree." So it was just an inadvertence on the lawyer's part, but it's not that there was any attempt to hide some fact, and it's there in the accompanying application. So then he says, "Okay, how did you come to know?" And I told him, "Okay, this is how we came to know of the decree." So he says, "But how do you show that summons were not served? What does the report of the process server say?" So I said, "The report of the process server shows that the summons were served on so-and-so address in Vasant Kunj, while my client is residing in Vasant Vihar." So the same address was served in Vasant Kunj. My client is in Vasant Vihar. So obviously it's not proper service. I have not been served. So Justice Nandraj Jog then said that what if it occurred to the mind of the process server that this was the wrong address and he served it on the correct address? So now I was slightly cornered, but I had the bravado to tell him that, "Your Lordship, this court cannot go by conjectures as to what would have occurred in the mind of the process server. The fact is that my address is in Vasant Vihar. I've been served at Vasant Kunj, which is evidently not proper service." So I don't know. I think he liked this bravado when I said this court cannot go by conjectures. And at that moment, I realized that now he's on our side. It was about half an hour that I had been arguing. He had been asking me various questions. These are some of the questions which I remember. And he asked the opposite counsel that, have you filed for execution? And the opposite counsel said, no, there's a stay on execution. I said, no, your lordship, I have filed an application for execution, stay on execution. That application is still listed today. It's not been decided. There's no stay as of now. And he started dictating the order. Now, I had understood that he's in my favor now, considering what all questions he had asked and what questions he had asked to the opposite counsel. And the client was getting very jittery. You know, he was prompting me from behind that, okay, say this, say that. I just told him that, you know, you just maintain your calm. And for the first 10 minutes, he was going on saying what the district judge has said, what the civil judge has said, what the ADJ has said. It was giving an impression that he's going to go with those judgments. And after saying everything, then he said, but in my opinion, the judges of the lower courts have adopted a very pedantic approach. And after that, the thing turned into our favor. So that is something which, that's one case which I cherish the most, because one, it was before a very difficult judge. It was my first final arguments, and we were successful against all odds. So that's something which I really, really, really cherish the most.
I guess, for those small things, you know, it actually attracts young lawyers like us, or even law students actually go for litigation, where, I mean, at least in our law school, we have this craze to do this corporate law job. But I mean, those moments, because, you know, make litigation very special, right? I guess. So, I mean, the next question being that, is there any case in the Supreme Court or the High Court of Delhi that you would have been a part of, you would have loved to be in a part of, or any M&A transaction which you would have been loved to be a part of?
I think I would have loved to be a part of the Keshav Nand Bharti case, 13-judge bench of the Honorable.
So, great, sir. So, the last question being that, what are your hobbies which you are pursuing in this lockdown, apart from lawyering? I mean, as a lawyer, you get very less time to actually pursue your hobbies, but any hobbies?
I like to read. I like to work out. And I spend a little time watching movies or web series. And how do I manage to find out the time is that I've incorporated all of them in my daily routine. So there's a fixed time at which I read. There's a fixed time at which I work out. And I have a 1 hour window at the end of the day where I watch TV, which could be anything. So I don't really need to separately take out time for them. But a lot of times what happens is that if the work pressure is a lot, suppose you have to, you know, work overnight and draft something urgent to be filed, obviously you can't follow your routine at that time. But I try to stick to the routine to the extent possible. So 6 days a week, I have this fixed routine. There's a fixed time at which I get up, and then, you know, every activity that follows till the time I start my work, that whole thing is fixed. And then I try to stop my work at a fixed time. And again, there's a night routine and there's a time for going off to sleep. So if you can manage that, if you can lead a disciplined life, you can find time for everything. Except, of course, as I said, there could be exigencies.
Right.
So if you are in a 36 hours negotiation, or if you are drafting something through the night, working through the night, it may not be possible. But it's always advisable, try to have a routine and try to stick to that.
Right. Exactly. I mean, I guess just to add on to that, I mean, apart from making a routine, I mean, it is one thing which I've also learned is that if you make a list of, you know, these are the 3-4 things which I want to do in this week. So that really helps. I mean, I guess many lawyers actually follow that, but yeah, for me, I mean, it really helps.
So what I do is that I figure out what I have to do in the month, and then I break it down into daily activities. And then I would plan my day the night in advance. So today before sleeping, I'll plan that what all do I have to do tomorrow. So that ways, you know, you can stay on track, and every Sunday you review your progress and see where you are, and it really helps.
Right. Great, great. Rajesh, what do you?
And sir, before we conclude the session, I would just want you to answer one last question. And being that, if possible, can you just share one anecdote which you will carry, which happened with you? One anecdote. Although you have, to some extent, you have answered it with the discourse with Pradeep, with Justice Pradeep Panandrajo. But I mean, if there is another of such anecdotes, then we would love to hear that.
So, well, there are many, many, many anecdotes, and let me. I think the one about getting into law, maybe I can elaborate on that a little further, because I said I'll take 2 or 3 minutes for that. That's something which is on top of my mind. So, from my childhood, I was quite weak and underweight. Okay. And my parents were very protective. They thought that this man cannot work hard. Okay. So they would always tell me to take the easier option. Or maybe it was some kind of a reverse psychology. Right. So when I used to be studying, they would say, Manish, go out and play. You keep studying all the time. Or when it came to class 10th and 11th, we had to choose the stream. They told me, okay, science is too difficult, take commerce instead, it's easier. Then again, when I completed my school, I'd got good marks, I could have easily got BCom honors. They said, no, BCom pass is easier. It has just 4 subjects, you'll be able to do it easily. I said, okay, I'll do BCom pass. And as I told you, for law, they said that, okay, CA is very difficult. Why don't you get into law, it's easier. So I think the very fact that my parents had zero expectations from me have really helped me become successful, because I've seen parents these days, they're kind of pushing their kids too much and telling them that you do this, you're not doing enough. For me, for my parents, I was always doing more than what they're expected. So I think it was also the right time when I stopped listening to them. That was when they told me that, okay, CLC is too far, North Campus is too far. We used to stay in Arkipuram and it will be a long commute. You will not be able to do it. You go to LC2, Law Center 2, which was the evening college. That was the first time when I put my foot down and I said, no, nothing doing. I am going to go to CLC and that's where I'm going to study. So that was the first time I did not follow their advice. But before that, the whole thing of becoming a lawyer was because they wanted me, not to work too hard and take the easy way out.
Great. And this is the first time
that what I would say is that kids these days and parents these days take too much pressure, right? They think too much, even law students, they take a lot of pressure. What will happen to my career? I think if you let go of all these apprehensions and just take up everything and give your best to everything that comes along, you'll be just fine. Eventually, there is a lot of work for everyone. There's a lot of abundance in this world. So if you're doing your work honestly, you will figure out a way. So just relax. Don't be too concerned about your career. The more nervous you'll be about success, more difficult it'll be. Just give it your best and results will follow.
So, sir, it was a great pleasure interacting with you. And we have learned a lot about alternative dispute resolution and the future of online dispute resolution. We also got to know a lot about you in person. And the story is really intriguing. And I hope anyone who is watching this interview will take a lot of insights back home. And thank you so much.